I am Christelle from Diabetes Strong, and in this video I'll be talking about handling diabetes, jet lag, and time zone changes. So specifically, I'll be going over how to adjust basal insulin or long-acting insulin when changing time zones. I was born and raised in Denmark, and I currently live in the US. I live in California, and I'll be flying back to Denmark soon to see family. And this trip, it's gonna be a 15 and a half hour flight, including layovers. It's a 9 hour time difference. So that does impact my blood sugars quite a bit. So I figured I would record my experience so you get a little bit of vlogging here, but I'll also be going over a medical guideline I've found for how to adjust your long-acting insulin for time zone changes. I will not be focusing on what I bring along for trips like this, how to get through security and all of that. I already did a video on that, so if that's what you're interested in, I'm leaving a link to that up here so you can go check that out. But let's dive in. Traveling over multiple time zones usually leads to jet lag as well as general sleep deprivation. So when that happens, you often become a little bit more insulin resistant. So that means that you need a little bit more insulin to manage your blood sugars until your body adapts to the new time zone. To ease the headache of blood sugar induced high blood sugars, you can nap, remember to drink plenty of water, exercise, and then of course adjust your insulin. If you travel over less than 5 time zones or gone no longer than 3 days, you might not need to make any changes to how you take your insulin. So if you use MDIs and multiple daily injections, you just continue to take your long-acting insulin at the normal time and your rapid-acting insulin for meals and corrections. And if you're on an insulin pump, you just change the time on your pump and go on with your life. However, please always consult with your medical team to see what's right for you. I use MDIs, multiple daily injections, to manage my diabetes. So I use an InPen, which is a smart pen. I'll leave a link to that up here to help me calculate my doses for my rapid acting insulin. And then I take a shot of Levemir in the morning and the evening as my long acting insulin. And I'm currently taking 16 units of my Levemir in the morning, and I'm taking 7 units in the evening. When I travel back to Europe or for any other longer trips, I don't really make any changes to my rapid acting insulin, but I do have to be mindful of when to take my Levemir and how much. I try to keep it as simple as possible. So when I travel east, so when I travel from California back to Denmark or to Europe, I will usually take my normal dose in the morning. So that's 16 units, and I usually take that at 8 a.m. I stay on California time while on the plane, and my nighttime insulin is usually scheduled for 10 p.m. But what I do is I push it out until 11 p.m. So at 11 p.m. I take my nighttime Levemir. 11 p.m. is 8 a.m. in Denmark, so my destination. That pushes me right back into my normal schedule of 8 a.m. and 10 p.m. Once I land, I'll switch all my clocks to Danish time, and I'll go directly back to my normal schedule. So that means at 10 p.m. Danish time, I'll take my full nighttime insulin dose of the 7 units. So you might have picked up on me saying, hey, I'm taking my nighttime insulin on a plane as well as my nighttime insulin when I get to Denmark. That technically means that I'm getting less long-acting insulin for about 24 hours, right? Because I'm doing 7 units in the evening, 16 units in the morning, I'm skipping that morning dose. So that does mean that I have to watch my blood sugars, I have to make sure that I don't trend high. So I will check in with my blood sugar quite often, do corrections if needed. So my approach is just to be cautious. I'll rather give myself a little bit more rapid acting insulin for corrections than having too much long acting insulin on board.
Hey guys, so we're at the airport. I did my full dose this morning at 8 a.m. I did the 16 units. I am still planning on doing my full evening dose at not 10 p.m. but 11 p.m. So pushing out 1 hour. So stay tuned, I'll let you know how it goes.
It is 11:06, blood sugar's okay. I'm ready to do shot. 7 units.
It is now day one here in Europe. I did give myself my full dose last night at 10 p.m. I gave the 7 units, and unfortunately I did go low this morning at 4:30 a.m. You see that up here. I'm not sure, however, that is due to my long-acting insulin. I think that might be because I did a correction late last night because I was running high, and I want to correct that. It's not the right move, but this just reality. But I'm gonna keep an eye on it over the next few days. I don't wanna repeat previous years when I was running low for days. So I'm gonna be watching a little bit, maybe reducing my long-acting insulin at night just a little bit. It's been a few days, and my learning for this trip is that I've needed way less nighttime insulin. So my Levemir at night have been cut way back to like 3. And I'm needing way more insulin during the daytime. So that one, I just upped my basal 1 unit. And then I've taken more insulin for meals and corrections. And that's the learning from this trip. It's been a little different depending on my trips. But for this trip, again, less insulin during the nighttime for the first 2 days and more during the day. So I have a slightly different strategy when I fly from east to west. So when I fly from Denmark back to California. So what I do is I still take my full dose in the morning, so the 16 units at 8 a.m. I will not change my clock to California time until I get off the plane, so I'll stay on Danish time. And then at 10 p.m., I'll do my full nighttime long-acting insulin. And then once I get off the plane, I'll change to California time. And then when 10 p.m. comes around, I'll take my nighttime insulin again, but I'll only take 50% of it. The reason for that is when I travel from Denmark to California, I lose 9 hours. So basically, if I was to take full dose, I would be stacking my Levemir. Those two doses would be too close, so that's why I cut it down by 50%. But that's how I do it. I also found a clinical guideline on Journal of Diabetes and Metabolic Disorders. So let's just go over that. So that also means that if your doctor does not have a clue about how to support you in managing your diabetes and time zone changes, you can bring that journal to your doctor. Maybe that can be helpful. I'll leave a link to the journal up here so you can see the clinical guidelines for yourself if you're interested. I will only be going over their clinical guidance for how to adjust long-acting insulin is taken twice a day, so like I do with my Levemir, as well as for insulin pumps. They do also have recommendations on how to adjust insulin, long-acting insulin is taken once a day. So if that's what you're interested, just click on the link and go check out their guidance. Let's start with the recommendation for eastbound travel for 5 hours or more. And this is a recommendation for anyone on MDIs, multiple daily injections, who split their long-acting insulin in 2 doses. When you travel east, we recommend that you still take your scheduled morning dose, so the full dose and scheduled time, and then that you keep your watch on your departing time zone. Once you're in the air and it's time for your evening dose, they do recommend that you reduce it and you do have to do a little bit of math. So yes, a little bit of math, but don't worry about it. I'll walk you through it. So I'm gonna show you the formula and I'm gonna do an example. So let's see, this is a formula that they suggest that you use to calculate your travel dose. Okay, so let's make an example. Let's say that you usually take 10 units of long-acting insulin morning and night, so that's 12 hours apart, and that you're traveling over 6 time zones. Okay, so let's just do the math together. So that's time zone 6 divided by 12, that's 0.5. 0.99 minus 0.5 is 0.4, multiply that by 10, and you get to your 4 units. So they, according to their recommendation, you should only take 4 units, not the full 10, on the plane for your nighttime dose. They then recommend that once you've taken your reduced nighttime dose, that you then set your clock to your destination's time zone. And then once you land, you're just back on regular schedule. So that means once you wake up in the morning, you're back to taking your regular morning dose. Now let's fly west. So this is the recommendation for westbound travel of 5 time zones or more. And this is for people using MDIs, multiple daily injections, where the long-acting insulin is split in 2 doses, morning and evening dose. The morning of the flight, they recommend that you take your full morning dose at the usual scheduled time. And then they recommend that you stay on your departing time zone once you're on the plane. And when your nighttime insulin is due, that you only do 50% of your usual dose. If you usually take 10 units, then you'll only take 5, but at the usual time. Once you land at your destination, you then switch your clocks to the destination time zone. And when your nighttime dose comes up again, you only do 50% of your scheduled dose. That way you're not getting too much long-acting insulin. And in the next morning when you wake up, you just resume your usual dosing and timing schedule. The recommendation for adjusting your pump settings if you travel over more than 5 time zones is very straightforward. They recommend that you stay on your departure time zone until you land. Then once you land, that you just change this time on your pump to the destination time zone. That way, all of your basal settings will be, let's say, updated to match the destination. However, you do have to remember that some of the insulin pumps, it's recommended that you take them off for departure as well as for landing, to make sure that you don't get any unintended insulin delivery from the pump. Now that we're on the ground, we're at our destination, the next question is, how do you then deal with being jet lagged? I don't have a good answer for you, unfortunately. Just being honest here, my last trip, I went low for a few days after arrival, but usually when I'm jet lagged and totally time zone confused, I'm actually very, very insulin resistant and need a lot more insulin. So my approach is that I stick with my usual settings, I stick with my usual carb ratios and my basal settings, but I do more finger sticks or I'll check my CGM more often and I'll do corrections when needed. To help you adjust, I've seen some recommendations that say, hey, you should start adjusting your sleep schedule to the time zone you're going to for a few days before you take off. So depending on which way you go, that'd be like go to bed 2 hours earlier, 2 hours later. It's not really something I've experimented with, but it might be helpful. And that is how I handle diabetes, jet lag, and time zone changes. As you probably picked up on, I do take a little bit more insulin than what the clinical guidelines I was describing recommend. And I always recommend that you go by clinical guidelines and what your medical team suggests to you. I was just showing you what I do. So again, I do encourage you to discuss any changes you want to make with your medical team just to be safe. If you found this video helpful and if you'd like to see more from me, please click that subscribe button. Remember to turn on notifications so you'll be informed whenever I post new content. I also appreciate any likes and comments below. Thank you so much for watching.